العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، أما بعد. So this is the third class in which we'll be discussing or studying the Manzuma of Sheikh Muhammad Sheikh Abdul Rahman bin Nasir al-Sa'di رحمة الله عليه رحمة واسعة. طيب, so we stopped on about the fourth line or the third line. ثم الصلاة مع سلام دائم على الرسول القرشي الخاتم أو خاتم وآله وصحبه الأبرار الحائز مراتب الفخار. اعلم هديت أن أفضل المنن علم لذي القلوب ويوصل العبد إلى المطلوب. احرص على فهمك للقواعد جامعة المسائل الشوارد لترتقي في العلم خير مرتقى وتقتفي سبل الذي قد وفق. هذه قواعد نظمتها من كتب أهل العلم قد حصلتها، جزاهم المولى عظيم الأجر والعفو مع غفرانه والبر. طيب, so that's the first 10 lines of this of these lines of poetry from Sheikh Abdul Rahman Nasir al-Sa'di rahmatullahi alayhi rahmatun wasi'a, in which he praises or he mentions them as a muqaddima, as an introduction for the principles that he is about to mention. Right, so we stopped at the fourth line in which the Sheikh rahmatullahi alayhi said, wallahda. We'll have the questions another time. على كل حال, the Sheikh starts off with, well, the third line, ثم الصلاة مع سلام دائم على رسول القرشي الخاتم أو خاتم. The Sheikh carries on after praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sends peace and salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ثم الصلاة مع سلام دائم على الرسول القرشي الخاتم أو خاتم. Therefore salutations and peace everlasting upon the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. That messenger being أولا from Quraysh, and secondly being the seal or the خاتم or the final of the messengers of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. طبعا it is an act of ibadah to send peace and salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man salla alayya marratan, sallallahu biha alayhi ashra." The one who says sallallahu alaihi wasallam once, then Allah subhanahu wa taala sends peace and salutations upon him as a return and as a reward, or in return and as a reward, 10 times. So if you say sallallahu alaihi wasallam once, then you will be getting the reward for saying it 10 times. So it will come back to you 10 times. Obviously more so on Fridays. We send peace and salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam more on Fridays than any other day. Also, even in our prayer at the end of the tashahud, we say Allahum salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. And many of the scholars say that that is a rukun, a pillar of the salah, a pillar of the salah, whereby if a person leaves it out, then his salah is invalid. As for the definition of as-salah, as-salat al-Nabi, the definition that many of the scholars praise and they constantly mention when they're talking about the salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the definition of Abu al-Aliyah, Rafi' ibn Mahran, who was a tabi'i. So Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi narrates in his kitab, in his jami', Sahih al-Jami', he says, that Abu Ali rahmatullahi alayhi, he says, As-salatu min Allah, we say salah min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is thana'uhu ala abdihi fil mala'il a'la. So the meaning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending peace salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praising the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the highest and in the loftiest of gatherings, yani with the angels. Because obviously we've been commanded to send peace and salutation upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna Allah wa malaikatuhu yusalluna ala nabi. Inna Allah wa malaikatuhu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. So that is the meaning of As-Salah ala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam min Allahi jalla wa ala ma' salamin, and asking for peace for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam during his lifetime, asking for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be saved and free from and to have peace from all harms, whether physical or ma'nawi, meaningful, then asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save him from it. Also, as-salam is from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Huwa alladhi, huwa Allahu alladhi la ilaha illa hu, al-malik, al-quddus, as-salam. As Allah jalla wa ala says in Surah Hashr. And obviously, as-salam, when we're talking about the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means the one who is free from all imperfections and free from all faults and is free from anyone resembling him subhanahu wa ta'ala in his names and his attributes. نعم دائما على الرسول القرشي الآمن الخاتمي. طيب, what is the difference between, or some of the مسائل that the scholars talk about and discuss is, what is the difference between a رسول and a نبي? A رسول and a نبي, are they the same or are they different? Obviously, if they are mentioned in two different verses or two different ahadith separately, then a Rasul and a Nabi can have or take the same meaning. However, if they're mentioned in the same siyaq, in the same context, in the same verse, or in the same hadith, then many of the scholars, rahmatullahi alayhim ajma'in, have said that there is a difference. So they say, mathalan, a Rasul, from the aqwal or the opinions, is that they say a Rasul is someone who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent revelation down upon and has been commanded to teach the people, has been commanded to call to that which he has been given, to the revelation that has been revealed unto him. So that's the first meaning of Rasul. Lakin as for Nabi, then a Nabi is someone who has been given a revelation, lakin he hasn't been commanded to call to that which has been revealed unto him. So that's the first kind of difference that the scholars mention. Like many of the scholars say that that is a weak opinion. Why? Because every single individual from the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the Ummah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is commanded to call to the Haqq. بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Teach the people about me, even if it's ayah. Or teach the people even if it is one ayah. How can it be the case, they say, that a Nabi, a Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can be given a revelation, like you're not commanded to call to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So that's one opinion. The second opinion, which is stronger in the side of Al-Ilm, they say that a Rasul is someone who has been given revelation, man uhiya ilayhi. So he's been given revelation, wahi, and obviously he's been commanded to call to the wahi. He's been commanded to call the people to that which he has been given. Right. The second definition of a Nabi, however, is someone who is renewing the revelation or the sharia of the Rasul that came before him. Someone who is renewing the revelation and the sharia of the Prophet that came before him. So, mathalan, many of the Prophets from Bani Israel, they were renewing the sharia of Musa alayhi salam. And obviously, that is the strongest opinion or the stronger opinion out of the two when talking about the differences between a Rasul and a Nabi. So, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, lakin, as the Sheikh says, is the last and the seal of the prophets, as Allah Jalla wa Ala says, wa khatam an-nabiyyin, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said, la nabiyya ba'di, la nabiyya ba'di. And obviously that is from The conditions of Iman, from the pillars of Iman, to believe in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to believe that he is the final messenger. And anyone that believes that there is a messenger that comes after him, then they have disbelieved in the Sharia of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. طيب. One can say, how can you say that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final messenger, whereas Isa alayhi salam will come after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Now the question is, how can you say that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the final prophet and there's no prophet after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? However, we know that Isa is a prophet and he's from the Ulul Azm, the five major scholars, five major Anbiya prophets, yet he will come after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What's the answer to that? Does anyone know? Ahsanti, what's your kunya? طيب أحسنتي. طيب نعم, as Salim said, حفظه الله, that Isa alayhi salam, yes, he will come towards Yawm al-Qiyamah. However, he will come as a servant and a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He won't come as a messenger. He won't come as a prophet, but he will come as a follower of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's wajib for us to get to know who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was, his lineage, to get to know his attributes, to read the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So it's important that we read the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam from time to time, even if it's a small portion, lacking we are in constant connection with the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we don't only obviously remember him in the Mawlid or during when those people from the people of Bid'ah celebrate the Mawlid of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We revive his Sunnah every single day in our lives. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. طيب, so the Sheikh says, rahmatullah alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi al-abrari al-ha'izi maratib al-fakhari. Then he carries on to send peace and salutations and making dua for the companions, for the family and the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al, the word al, means atba', followers. The word al means atba'. So Allah Jalla wa ala says, an-naru yu'raduna alayha ghuduwan wa ashiyya. وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةُ أَدْخِلُوا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ أَشَدَّ الْعَذَابِ. So Allah Jalla wa Ala mentions, when the people of Fir'aun are being exposed to the fire day and night, to the punishment of Allah Jalla wa Ala day and night, then يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ, they will be exposed to a more severe torment and punishment. لكن Allah Jalla wa Ala, so Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَيَوْمَ تَأَدْخِلُوا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ, the people of Fir'aun, يعني his followers, not his family, لكن his followers. طيب. لكن in this سياق, in this context, when we're talking about وآله وصحبه الأبرار, what is the meaning of آل? Is it the Sahaba or the followers of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or is it the آل, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why? Because آل can mean أتباع, can also mean آل as in family the qaraba of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the qaraba, the family of a person. So what is the meaning in this context? Ala kul hal, the scholars mention that when these two words are mentioned along with one another, then al means, so when al and sahb are mentioned along with one another, then al is relating to the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the believing members of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The believing members or people from the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Lakin, if al is mentioned alone, sa'afun, so wa alihi, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, wa sahbihi, the followers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Lakin, if only one of them is mentioned, yani wa alihi, if someone says, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alihi, wa ala alihi, then the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are also included in that, and the meaning is atba', the followers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَالصَّحْبِهِ الْأَبْرَارِ, as for the Sahaba, or as for the definition of a Sahabi, he is مَنْ لَقِيَ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, the one, or the definition of a Sahabi, which I assume you're writing this down, like in the definition of a Sahabi is مَنْ لَقِيَ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, the one who met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. مُؤْمِنًا بِهِ, whilst believing in him. Whilst believing him, because there were many people that met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, lakin did not believe in him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa mata ala dalik, and he died upon that. So he met the messenger, the sahabi, someone who met the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, male or female, someone who met the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Amana bihi, believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa mata ala dalik, and he died upon that, salawatullahi wasallamu alaihi. Some of the scholars include حتى لو تدخل ولو تخلل ولو تخللت غدة بينها ولو تخللت غدة بينها أو فيها. So even if the person left, apostated from the religion of Islam and then came back into it, and then came back into Islam. على كل حال, الصحابي is من آمن بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, من لقي بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, أو من لقي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, آمن به ومات على ذلك. طيب, the scholars also mention وصحبه, the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, in order to refute the غوافدة عليهم من الله ما يستحقون, those who send peace and salutations upon the آل of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, لكن they curse the companions of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم except a few. As for the virtues of the Sahaba, then they are many. والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين تبعوهم الآية محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم. نعم. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised them in the Quran many times. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the خير الناس قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. So he praised the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. He praised, and the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised the companions. He said, the best of the people, the best of my nation is my generation. Then those that follow them, then those that follow them. So the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are the most virtuous of people after the Anbiya. The most virtuous of people after the Anbiya. So we have to send peace and salutations. We have to make dua for them every time. رجال صدقوا ما عهد الله عليه. They were people who were true to the covenant and agreement that they had with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the bay'ah, the allegiance that they gave to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they supported him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and aided him when everyone else disbelieved in him, and they were willing to sacrifice themselves and their families for the sake of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is the belief and the i'tiqad of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And anything that happened between the Sahaba, we stay quiet about it. It's nothing to do with us. The khilaf that happened as a result of the people of Ahlul Fitan, then we have to leave it off, and we cannot get involved in that which took place in the group between the Sahaba radhiyallahu ta'ala alayhim. Al-Abrari al-Ha'izi maratib al-Fakhari. And obviously, the Sahaba ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim, they were those who were given glorious ranks in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we mentioned the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which he praised the companions ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim, radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhu. Allah jalla wa ala is pleased with them, and they are pleased with him. Also, the fact that they are the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's not something that just happened. Mathalan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as his messenger, and then all of a sudden these people came around. Abu Bakr came around and accepted Islam, Umar and Ali and Uthman and so on. La, it was a wahi min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, istifa'u min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who chose these companions to be the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just like he, jalla wa ala, chose Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be his messenger. طيب, قال الشيخ رحمة الله عليه, اعلم هديت أن أفضل المنن علم يزيل شك عنك والدارن. The Shaykh رحمة الله عليه here, in this line and the next line, ويكشف الحق لذي القلوب ويوصل العبد إلى المطلوب. In these two lines, he mentions four benefits of العلم. The Sheikh رحمة الله عليه, in these four lines, mentions four, or in these two lines, he mentions four benefits of العلم. So he says, know may you be guided, يعلم, that the most virtuous of blessings, the greatest of blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ilm, knowledge. What is the attribute of that knowledge, of the character of that knowledge, the characteristic of that knowledge? Ilmun yuziru shakka anka wa dhaga. It is knowledge that removes doubt and dirt of sins. It is the ilm that removes shubuhat and shahawat. وَيَكْشِفُ الْحَقَّ لِذِي الْقُلُوبِ, and it exposes the truth to those who possess hearts, those who are from Ahlul Iman. وَيُوصِلُ الْعَبَّ إِلَى الْمَطْلُوبِ, and it leads a person to reach that which he seeks. So when a person takes a path, ilm, a path to ilm, then by him seeking this knowledge, he will gain the reward, or he will gain what it was that he was seeking, which was al-ilm. So the ilm that is being referred to is al-ilm al-shar'i. Al-ilm al-shar'i. Knowledge of the sharia of al-Islam. Knowledge of the kitab and the sunnah. And anytime you see a verse, or you come across a verse or hadith praising al-ilm, then that is al-ilm of the sharia of al-Islam. And no other ilm comes into it. So ala kulli hal, the Sheikh says, i'lam hudita, making dua for the person who is seeking knowledge. Hudita, may you be guided, and you may be give, may you be given the tawfiq of hidayah. So al-ilm is, as preceded, the virtues of ilm are many. Lakin ala kulli hal, that is what ilm does. It removes the doubts of a person. It removes doubts, and a person will be guided to the haqq in the masail that Ahlul Sunnah differ with Ahlul Bid'ah, and the Muslims in general differ with the Kuffar. So that person who has ilm will be free from shubuhat. From shubuhat. Because even if someone mentions a doubt or throws a doubt his way, they are able to repel it with al-ilm, knowledge. Seeking knowledge, learning it, and referring back to it. Tayyib. So obviously, as we know, there are many virtues for ilm. يغفر الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات قل هل يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. Verily, the scholars are those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises the believers in ranks, and he raises those who have ilm in ranks which are higher than those of the believers. يزيل الشك عنك والدرج. Also, from the attributes of ilm, which is العلم النافع, is it removes shubuhat and it removes shahawat from the person. So it doesn't mean that the person who seeks knowledge or the alim won't fall into sin, lakin it means that he will be further away from falling into sin. And even if he does fall into a sin, then he or she is quick to repent back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sheikh Abdul Rahman ibn Nas, Abdul Rahman Sa'd rahmatullah alayhi, he mentioned when he's got explanation or commentary on these lines of poetry that he has laid down. He says rahmatullah alayhi, wa tabidu al-ilm an-nafi', and the tabid, or the criterion for the ilm that is nafi', that is beneficial, kama qultu fi an-nadhmi, annahu yuzilu 'an al-qalbi shay'ain. That the criterion, or how you can know if that ilm is beneficial, is that it removes two things. It removes two things from the heart. Ash-shubuhat wa shahawat. Shubuhat, doubts, and shahawat, and desires, worldly desires. For shubuhat to turitu shak. For shubuhat, bring about a shak, having doubt in the haqq, in the truth. Shubuhat, doubts, bring about a person to have a doubt about the haqq. طيب. والشهوات تورث ضرر القلب وقسوته. As for shahawat, sins in general, they cause for the heart to become dirty and rusty, and it causes the heart to harden. So when they remember, when they hear the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa'ala, when they hear the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they won't be affected by it. Their hearts won't tremble. Their hearts won't fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their eyes won't water. They won't shed a tear. So that is from the effects of sins. وَتُثْبِتُ الْبَدَنَ عَنِ الطَّاعَاتِ And it thwarts and it diverts the heart away from, or the body away from, the remembrance of Allah, the ta'a, and the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. Then the Shaykh says, رحمه الله عليه, أن أفضل الملل علم يزيل عنكم الشك والدرك. So, علم is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like Allah Jalla wa'ala gives different blessings to different people, ilm is from the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to those servants that He loves. So al-ilm, Allah Jalla wa'ala only gives to those servants whom He loves. Why? Because al-ulama warathatul al-anbiya. The scholars are the inheritors of the anbiya. And the anbiya, the prophets, they do not leave behind dinar and dirham. They don't leave behind worldly possessions. They leave behind al-ilm. So anyone that takes it has taken a great portion. Anyone that takes a part of ilm has taken a part of prophethood. That's why Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, on one occasion, he saw the people turning away from al-ilm. He saw that the masjid was almost mahjub. People have made hijrah from the masjid and they weren't attending the masjid, even though there were classes taking place in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or in the masjid that he was referring to. So he said to the people, after going to them in the market and seeing them, he said to them, radiallahu anhu, what is it, why do I see you in the market, or why do I see you over here, when the inheritance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is being given out? And they thought that it was the worldly benefits that was given out in the masjid. Why? Because whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would be given out things, then he would be very generous. So they went to the masjid, and all they saw was people sitting down and talking about the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, discussing Qala Allah wa Qala Rasul. And then they said to him, and they kind of said, you said that the inheritance was being given out. He said, that is the inheritance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So anyone that takes a part of ilm has taken a part of prophethood. And that ilm brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why it's extremely important that a person, when seeking knowledge, they have to have the intention of seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure and getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you sitting here in this class, or you sitting in the class, logging on and listening to the class, that is an act of ibadah. That is an act of ibadah that you have to have constantly to mind and to believe that you're getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, when seeking knowledge, it's important for the student of knowledge to seek knowledge under the scholars of Ahlul Ilm, of Ahlul Sunnah, to read their books, to listen to their lectures, because only they are the ones that remove the doubts from the people of, from the Muslims. As for Ahlul Bid'ah, the people of Ahlul Bid'ah, they bring about shubuhat and doubts to the hearts of the people. So it's important that when seeking knowledge, you have to seek the knowledge from Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. وَيَكْشِفُ الْحَقَّ لِذِ الْقُلُوبِ وَيُوصِلُ الْعَبْدَ إِلَى الْمَطْلُوبِ The next line in which the Shaykh talks about the benefits of ilm, he says, وَيَكْشِفُ الْحَقَّ لِذِ الْقُلُوبِ And he exposes the truth to those people who possess hearts, to the people of Iman. So, al-ilm gives you light. It opens the door of understanding for you. And it helps you reach your goal. It helps you reach your goal and your aim of seeking knowledge. And obviously, we've been commanded by Allah Jalla wa'ala to refer back to the people of knowledge. Allah says, فَسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ And the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, مِنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَسْمِسْ فِيهِ عِلْمًا سَهَلُ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِهِ طَرِيقًا الْجَنَّةِ So, al-ilm gives you the path to Jannah, or makes easy for you the path to reach Jannah. With regards to, or when talking about the benefits of, or the virtues of Ahlul Ilm, Ibn Qudama rahmatullah alayhi, his kitab Al-Mughni, Sheikh Hajj al-Mushayrak mentions in his Sharh, Ibn Qudama is from the scholars of the Hanabila. He's got a book called Al-Mughni. So many of you may know the kitab, Lum'at al-I'tiqad. The author is Ibn Qudama rahmatullah alayhi rahmatullah wasi. He's got many books in fiqh, usul al-fiqh, so in aqidah. Like in this book he has, is called Al-Mughni, and it's in, it's fiqh muqaran almost. It's, well it is. He mentions all of the aqwal and the opinions of all of the madahibs, about 15 or something volumes. So he mentions in this book, rahmatullah alayhi, in the muqaddimah, that in the previous nations, those who used to govern and rule were the prophets that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to send. So these prophets used to look after the people, used to govern them and bring them benefits and so on, and remove harm from them and so on. Lakin, in this ummah, since the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was and is the final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he says, فَإِنَّ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ إِنَّمَا وَرَثُوا الْعِلْمِ. So the prophets, they leave behind the ilm. Lakin he mentions that the ulama, أن العلماء في هذه الأمة, the ulama, the scholars in this ummah, بمنزلة الأنبياء, they are in the position, in the station of the Anbiya fil umam al-sabiqa. So the scholars of this ummah have the same station as the prophets of the previous nations. Not in the fact that they're more virtuous, like in the fact that they play the same role. Where the scholars of the past, or the Anbiya of the past, مثلا بني Israel, they had many prophets. These prophets were called into the haqq, and they were teaching the people the religion of Islam. In our ummah, we won't have any prophet after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like we have scholars who are carrying out the role of the Anbiya. Hence, we have to love and respect our scholars. And the Sheikh Hassan al-Banna, Hassan Abdul Wahab al-Banna, rahmatullahi alayhi rahmatan wasi'a, who has reached almost 100, passed away yesterday in Egypt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon him. And the Shaykh rahmatullah alayhi used to love teaching the lessons of Tawheed. Kitab al-Tawheed, he taught it a few hours before his death, or maybe a day before his death. And when he was in hospital recently, he asked the doctors to finish what they were doing because he needed to get back to explaining the books of Tawheed. So rahmatullahi alayhi rahmatan wasi'a. And when an alim passes away in this ummah, that is a great loss. That is a great loss to this whole ummah. May Allah Jalla wa'ala have mercy upon him. Qala Shaykh al-Sa'di rahmatullahi alayhi, fahris ala fahmika lil qawa'idi jami'at al-masa'i lil shawaridi. So the Shaykh rahmatullahi alayhi mentions in the next line, which is still obviously in the muqaddimah, lakin he says, focus on your understanding of these principles which connect together masail, that are dispersed issues or vagrant issues that are here and there, issues that are dispersed in different chapters, in different books. Then pay attention, because these qawa'id will bring together for you all of these different issues. Na'am. Ala fahmika lil qawa'id. So having knowledge of principles in general make al-ilm easier. Understanding ilm, they make it easier. Because, well, it's not only in al-fiqh, lakin in nahu, in usul al-fiqh, in ilm al-hadith, in tafsir, in any knowledge, in aqidah. If you have the principles and the usul, and you can refer back to these foundations, then you're easily able to understand all of the masail that come about in that specific chapter, in that specific issue, regardless of its rulings. So you will be able to understand the masail that are similar and the masail, the issues that differ, if you use al-qawa'id. And that's why the scholars rahmatullah alayhim, they praise the books of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayhi a lot more than any of the other scholars. When we talked about muqaddimah and the benefits of learning usul, a couple of weeks ago we mentioned that Shaykh Abd al-Rahman al-Sa'di rahmatullah alayhi, he praises the books of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and Shaykh al-Islam ibn Qayyim rahmatullah alayhima. And the reason why he praises them is because they give importance to these qawa'id and these principles. They make easier the chapters of fiqh in general. طيب لترتقي في العلم خير مبتقى وتقتفي سبل الذي قد وفق. So the Sheikh rahmatullah alayhi mentions that by you learning these qawa'id and understanding them, you are able to progress well and ground yourself well in knowledge. Also, you are following the path of those who are given success, meaning the past scholars. Because when you look into the books of Al-Ilm, they follow the same methodology in seeking knowledge and also in teaching knowledge. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكِنْ كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابَ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَدْرُسُونَ. When this surah or this verse in Surah Al-Imran, when the scholars are explaining it, when they're talking about who the alim, the rabbani, that nurtures students is, they mention, they say, هُوَ الَّذِي يُرَبِّي النَّاسَ عَلَىٰ صِغَارِ الْعِلْمِ قَبْلَ كِبَارِهِ. The alim, the rabbani, the well-grounded scholar is the one who nurtures the people upon the small masail of ilm, the small issues of al-ilm, قَبْلَ كِبَارِهِ, before going on to the major issues. That is a very important methodology to follow. So for example, مثلاً, you will find people who have no idea or have never studied Kitab al-Tahara or Kitab al-Salah or Kitab al-Siyam, which are in general in the beginning parts of every book of fiqh, talking about masail of jihad, issues to do with jihad, or masail of ridda, people apostating. Naam, these books, jihad and Kitab al-Ridda and so on, they are from fiqh, they are from the Sharia of Islam. Lakin, the person who studies Kitab al-Tahara and Kitab al-Salah and so on and moves on, will reach the Kitab of al-Jihad, will reach the Kitab of Ridda and so on. And then he can discuss these issues and study them according to the methodology of Ahlul Ilm. Lakin, for a person to leave off these masail of Tahara and so on and move on to the big issues, then know that he has differed in the methodology he has taken in terms of seeking knowledge to the methodology of Ahlul Ilm. And obviously this is something that isn't practiced in this country. It is not something which is practiced. Now, for example, in this, the kitab we're studying now, it's called Qawa'id al-Fiqhiyya. It is from the books that many people study, the scholars recommend as a madkhal or as an entering point for al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, and it obviously serves al-fiqh in general. There are 13 people present. There are 13 people studying this kitab, 13 students. Now, numbers don't carry any meaning. Why? Because these 13 are worth 300 students. Like, what I'm getting at is, if when the i'lam was going out, or the advertisement for the class, the poster was going out, if we were to make, or if the brothers at Al-Ihtisam were to title a lecture, organize a lecture with the title of the reality of the agreement between UAE, the United Arab Emirates, and Israel. If you give a title like that, or the correct stance of a Muslim with regards to the agreement between the United Arab Emirates and Israel, you will find that there'd be no space in this room. You would find that there would be hundreds of people listening. You will find that maybe after a week there'd be thousands and thousands and thousands of views. Why is that? Does anyone know why? I believe all your mics are unmuted. Does anyone know why this happens? Or can anyone benefit us? People are not interested in knowledge. They couldn't care less. They couldn't care less. They don't care. Like when it comes to issues that do not concern them, when it comes to issues that do not concern them, you will find that they're at the forefront. Issues that have no concern in them. They have no say in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not answer them. Lakin, you will find that they're constantly at the forefront. They're constantly listening to what is going on. They're constantly following the news, what's the latest, the developments, and so on. Lakin, when it comes to how they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they don't care. And it's not just this class where you will get 13 people or so. Recently, Sheikh Khalid al-Mushaykh came to the UK. Sheikh Khalid al-Mushaykh, Hafidhahullah, who's from the students of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala, who's from the scholars of Qasim, came to the United Kingdom. And there were only about 14, 15 students benefiting from the Sheikh. So when an alim comes, you will find that people don't care. They don't want to benefit. Especially given the fact that Sheikh Khalid al-Mushaykh was teaching his takhassus, he was teaching umdatul fiqh. Like people didn't want to benefit. Why? Because ilm is thaqeel. It is heavy. It takes time. It requires attending the class. It requires taking notes, paying attention, revising, sitting exams, and so on. Like in listening to a lecture is easy. Listening to a lecture is easy. And then you go away, mashallah, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. And then you find people talking about issues which are kibar, major issues, issues that the scholars run away from, they flee from, they won't answer. Mathalan, issues to do with takfir. If you go ask Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan, hafizahullah, he'll refer you over to the Mufti, and he will say, go to Dar al-Iftah, the place or the center where the scholars get together for Dar al-Iftah, Lajnah al-Da'imah. Issues like that, Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan, Sheikh Abbad, all of the scholars, they run away from these issues. Like you will find the shabab, the youth, they're hasty in saying, Fulan's mubtadi', Fulan is a kafir, Fulan is this, Fulan is that. And it's usually the boys, it's usually the brothers that are like that. You won't really find sisters arguing over who's a mubtadi' and who's a sunni and who's a salafi. It's usually the brothers. And ma'al asaf al-shadeed, it's usually the brothers that don't attend classes. Lakin, in a way, I don't blame these students. They're not students, I don't blame these brothers, these common awam. I don't blame them. Because the tarbiyah, they haven't been nurtured and they haven't been given the tarbiyah or the correct tarbiyah of Ahlul Ilm. Do you think when Sheikh Fawzan has a lesson or a lecture or when he's in his office, he'll entertain people who come to him with issues of fitan? Ma ra'yuk fi fulan, ma ra'yuk fi fulan, what do you think of fulan, what do you think of fulan? La, the answer is la, he won't answer. Some people have actually gone to the Sheikh in his office and they've asked him about some of these issues, and the Sheikh just looked away, just didn't answer. And even in his lessons, some people ask these sorts of questions, fulan, 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 and halakul hal, he doesn't answer them. He rebukes the questioner, the one who's reading out, not the question, the one who's reading out the question. So these sorts of questions don't even get asked in the majalis of Ahlul Ilm. Lakin you will find that in the West, because of the tarbiyah that we've been given, you will find that people involve themselves in things that shouldn't concern them, that don't concern them, that they shouldn't bother themselves with. And that's the role of the students of ilm, al-talab al-ilm. That's where the students of al-ilm, talab al-ilm, they have to take the people away from this battlefield and take them into the maidan, the battlefield of al-ilm. Qala Allah, wa qala Rasul, wa qala Sahaba, wa qala al-alim fulani. That's where the real ilm is. So the role of the student of knowledge, he diverts the people from fitan, qila, wa qal, and he takes them over to the maidan and the arena of al-ilm, in which kutub, the books of Ahlul Ilm, are to be studied. And their statements are understood. So a student learns and then teaches. If this was, or if this becomes the methodology and the tariqah that we follow, you will find a lot of khair in this country. Ala kulli hal, it's very important that the student gives importance to these mutul that people are studying. So مثلا, if a person wants to study عقيدة, they start with أصول الثلاثة, قواعد الأربعة, نواقض الإسلام, أصول الستة, كتاب التوحيد, كشف الشبهات, العقيدة الواسطية, and so on. العقيدة الطحاوية, لمعة الاعتقاد, these sorts of books. Then when it comes to fiqh, the person starts with a matn which is fiqh, depending on the madhab of that country. So if you're in a mathalan in a Hanbali country, then you start with Zad al-Mustaqna. If you're in a country which they follow the madhab of the Shafi'iyya, you follow mathalan and mathnab al-Shuja', and so on, ala kulli hal. Then when it comes to al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, you start with mathalan this madhab that we're starting now, al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya al-Sheikh Sa'di. And then there are other mutun that follow on from this. So there are some that are 500 lines. Now this is only about 50, 60 lines. Like there are some, Dhul al-Bahiyya, mathalan, which is in Qawa'id al-Fiqhiyya, and it's about 500 something lines. And then likewise, you have the Qawa'id al-Usul, Lishaykh ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala. Then you have Ilm Usul al-Fiqh, and you start from the beginning. For example, Safwat al-Usul, or Tashil al-Usul, which was offered by Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Sa'di rahmatullah alayhi, then ilm min ilm al-usul, and then waraqat, and so on. So there's tadarruj. I mean, you constantly go up the ladder shay'an for shay'an. Then ilm al-hadith mathalan, bulugh al-maram, or umdat al-ahkam, then bulugh al-maram. And when we're talking about the usul of mustalah hadith, you study البيقونية مثل البيقونية نخبة الفكر نزهة النظر and so on. على كل حال, these are some of the benefits of studying العلم according to the طريقة of العلم.